Good morning, everyone. This is Dr. Bharti Garg, Assistant Professor, Department of Public Administration, Punjab University, Chandigarh. Today, I'm going to discuss the topic of recruitment of civil services in India. At the end of this module, friends, you will be able to understand the meaning of recruitment, the types of recruitment, various methods of recruitment, how the civil servants are recruited in India, and what are the problems in the pattern of recruitment of civil servants in India. The quality of governance depends on the quality of the civil servants manning different positions in an organization. And quality of civil servants depends on the quality of the recruitment process. That is, whether those civil servants are recruited in the equitable, fair, transparent, right manner or not. So recruitment becomes all the more important for taking right kind of civil servants for the various organizations. Now, Government of India, being the largest employer of the country, it recruits civil servants through various institutional mechanisms in the country. For the purpose, the Government of India has set up different institutions to carry out the recruitment process. For example, Union Public Service Commission conducts recruitment of the All India Services and Central Civil Services. State Public Service Commission conducts recruitment of the state civil servants. There is a Staff Selection Commission which conducts recruitment for various positions. Even departments are authorized to carry out recruitment process at the departmental level. Now we are going to discuss the meaning and definition of recruitment. Now, recruitment is the cornerstone of the entire personnel administration. It is the first step in the entire process of placing a right person at the right position. Recruitment is about attracting the right person for the right positions. So it is a linking activity, linking those having jobs and those seeking jobs. Marshall Dimmock has very candidly discussed the recruitment. According to Marshall Dimmock, recruitment is securing right person for the right job, either through advertising for a large group of people or tracking some individual employees for the specific tasks. Modern system of recruitment is based on three broad principles, that is competence, neutrality, and equality of opportunity. Competence means that civil servants will serve the government in an intelligent and efficient manner. Neutrality means that civil servants will serve any political party without being influenced by its ideologies. And equality of opportunity means that all those having the capability to serve the government have been provided equal opportunities to be recruited in the government for various positions and serve the government. Friends, now we are going to discuss the significance of recruitment. We must remember that recruitment is the cornerstone of the entire personnel administration. Recruitment process must be taken very seriously because a person once selected will serve the government or any organization for his entire lifetime. So a mistake made at the initial stages of selecting the wrong person and then placed in an organization will become a burden for an organization. Thus, it is very important that the recruitment process should be scientifically and objectively designed. It must be carried out in an impartial manner, in an unbiased way, so that right person with high integrity and high ethical moral values is selected and be placed at the right position. Only then he will be able to give his best to the organization and organization will be able to draw his best. So recruitment, which is the foundation of the entire personnel administration, must be considered in a right manner, must be carried out in a right manner, so that right person is selected, right person with right values and right mindset is selected for various positions in an organization. Besides, in the modern times, recruitment has become all the more important because in the modern times, due to developments in science and technology, people are demanding more and more specialization and efficient services. Besides, the present day times is of citizen-centric governance, participative governance, transparent and corrupt-free government. So it must be ensured that right person with such mindset as to involve the citizens so as to ensure transparent government, good governance, etc. is selected. So recruitment process has become all the more important. It has acquired more importance in the present day times, so that these needs of the government are fulfilled by the right person at the right place. Friends, now let us discuss the difference between recruitment and selection. Recruitment and selection, they are two parts of the employment process, but there are differences between the two. The first difference between the two is that recruitment is stimulating the candidates to apply for the various positions, whereas selection is the series of steps which are taken to screen the candidates and to select the candidate through the process of examinations, etc. The second difference between recruitment and selection is that the basic purpose of recruitment is to create a talent pool of candidates for the selection of right candidates, whereas the basic purpose of selection is to carry out the selection process through examinations for the selection of right person for the right job. The third and the last difference between recruitment and selection is that recruitment is a positive activity where the candidates are encouraged to apply for various positions, whereas selection is a negative activity which involves screening of ineligible candidates from various positions. Now friends, this slide is about the entire recruitment process. As you can see, recruitment process involves series of steps right from the first step, that is requisition of the positions, to the determination of the qualification, designing of the application form, advertisement, scrutiny of the application form, conducting of the examination and interview, selecting the candidate, certification of the candidate, placing the right person at the right position. So it involves series of steps which start with the requisition of the post and ends with the placement of the candidate to the position for which he has been selected. Now, discussing the details of the recruitment process, requisition of the post means asking various government departments about the vacancies in their departments, so that a centralized recruiting agency, which may be either UPSC or State Public Service Commission or any other central recruiting agency, can start with the recruitment process. After the posts have been requisitioned, the next step involves determining the qualifications which are required of the candidates for filling up various positions, and then designing of the application forms so that candidates can apply for various positions in an organization. The next steps are the advertisement of the posts. Now, advertisements are given in the newspapers, broadcasted online through print media as well as through electronic media. After that, the candidates, they apply for various positions, and then the scrutiny of the applications is done by the recruiting agencies. Next step is holding of the examinations and interviews by the central recruiting agencies, and then after the selection, their names are certified, that is, the names are sent to the main personnel agency, that these are the candidates who have been selected, and their names are then certified by the central personnel agency for appointment. After certification of the name comes the appointment of the candidate, that is, appointment letter is issued to the candidate, and the last is the placement of the candidate. That is, after entering into the service, he is seated, he is placed on his position, and then he is ready to perform the duties and responsibilities of his position. Now we are going to discuss types of recruitment. The first is the direct recruitment. Now, direct recruitment is carried out through examinations and interviews, and candidates are chosen from the open market. Now, this is an open system of recruitment where all the eligible candidates are free to apply, and they are given equal chance to apply and be appearing for the interview. On the other hand, the second type of recruitment is indirect recruitment. Indirect recruitment is also known as promotion. Indirect recruitment is not carried out through the open market recruitment process, but all the candidates who are already working in an organization are given a chance to apply for vacant higher positions, and then they are promoted or indirectly recruited for those positions. As against direct recruitment, indirect recruitment is only for those who are working in an organization. Candidates are not chosen from open market. Another type of recruitment is positive recruitment and negative recruitment. Positive recruitment is one when the recruiting agency involves in carrying out the recruitment process in a positive manner. That is, it calls on the eligible candidates to apply for various positions through advertisements, propaganda, and highlighting the benefits of joining a service. Whereas negative recruitment is one in which the unqualified and ineligible candidates, they are kept out of the service, and such means are used where such candidates don't apply for various positions in an organization. Another type of recruitment is mass recruitment and individual recruitment. Mass recruitment is one when large number of non-technical, unspecialized positions are to be filled up, and there are number of vacancies, large number of vacancies which are to be filled up. On the other hand, individual recruitment is one which is carried out just for a specific few positions and which require technical specialized knowledge. So mass recruitment is carried out through number of ways, like positions in mass media, etc. So which are general in nature, whereas the posts which require specialized training, specialized skills for its performance, individual recruitment process is carried out. Now friends, we are going to discuss the existing pattern of recruitment of civil servants in India. Now the recruitment of civil servants in India goes back to the colonial days. Prussia was the first country to have introduced the open competition for the civil servants. In India, in 1853, the East India Company had started with the merit system in India. And for the purpose, Public Service Commission was set up in 1926, which was renamed as Federal Public Service Commission in 1935 under the Government of India Act 1935. After independence, new services were created, that is Indian Administrative Service, IAS, Indian Foreign Service, IFS, and Indian Police Service, IPS. Now, between 1947 and 1950, the open competition examination was conducted for these services, and candidates were required to take 3 optional subjects, whereas for the IPS, only 2 optional subjects were required. In 1950, when the Constitution of India came into force, Federal Public Service Commission was renamed as Union Public Service Commission, which was given the responsibility for carrying out the recruitment of the All India Service and Central Civil Service officers. Now, since independence, various commissions and committees have recommended and have given suggestions for the improvement of the recruitment of the civil servants in India. For example, first ARC had suggested changes in the age limit for those appearing for the civil services examination. In line with that, Kothari Committee in 1976 had given major recommendations, and it is on the basis of the recommendations of the Kothari Committee that the present 3-stage system of civil services examination is conducted. And these 3 stages are the preliminary examination, mains examination, which involves written, as well as viva voce examination. Kothari Committee, interestingly, had also recommended conducting tests after the foundation training. So the present pattern of recruitment of the civil servants in India is largely based on the recommendations given by Kothari Committee in 1976. After Kothari Committee, also number of commissions and committees were set up which had suggested reforms in the recruitment of the civil servants in India, but not much changes have taken place, except that Satish Chandra Committee had recommended the introduction of essay paper in the mains written examination, which was included. Though in 2011, major change in the recruitment process of the civil servants had taken place. In 2011, Union Public Service Commission had introduced a major change in the first stage of the examination, that is the preliminary examination, whereby it had introduced a new scheme of examination. In the preliminary examination, 2 papers of objective type nature were conducted. Paper 1 was of 200 marks, which was of general studies paper, and paper 2, which was previously used to be optional paper, was now civil services aptitude test. It carried 80 marks and was of 2 hours duration. Now the main purpose was that those candidates who were entering the civil services, they must have administrative capability to assess the situations in the right manner, rather than just roting, having rote knowledge of the subject which they were previously having. So presently, the recruitment of the civil servants is carried out through a three-stage examination process. That is, the stage 1 is the civil services aptitude test, which is also known as the preliminary examination. Stage 2 is the written test, which comprises of the written examination, and then the interview or the viva voce examination. The main purpose of the first stage, that is the preliminary examination, is to test the aptitude and aptitude and the skill determining qualities of the civil servants rather than just emphasizing on rote memorization of the facts. CSAT, that is Civil Services Aptitude Test, comprises of two papers, paper 1 and paper 2. Paper 1 is of 2 hours, having 200 marks. It has objective type questions from subjects like current events, history, political system, geography, and English comprehension skills. Paper 2 again is of 200 marks and of 2-hour durations. It has 80 questions and it deals with decision-making skills of the candidate, logical reasoning, comprehension skills, and basic numeracy skills, etc. Overall, the preliminary examination is of 400 marks. Now, the preliminary examination is a screening examination. Out of those who are selected, they are then eligible to appear for the mains written examination. UPSC had introduced a new pattern of mains examination in the year 2013. It has introduced English comprehension, Prezi, and essay paper as qualifying papers. Those students who qualify these papers, only their papers are further checked. Mains examination comprises of 4 general studies papers of 250 marks each, 1 optional papers having 2 papers in that optional subject with 250 marks each. Those who qualify in the written examinations, they are called for the interview test and the personality test is of 275 marks. So friends, here is the detail of all the 9 papers which a candidate writes in the main examination. As you can see, paper 1 is one of the Indian languages which a candidate chooses to write for. Candidate has to choose one language out of those mentioned in the Constitution of India. Then it has English paper, essay paper, and then general studies paper, optional papers, etc. Now, after the written examination, the last stage in the recruitment process is carried out, that is the personality test. Those who clear the written examination, they are called for the interview. Now, a board comprising of experts, they interview the candidates. The board members have a record of the entire educational career of the candidate. The purpose of the interview is not to judge the factual knowledge of the candidate, but the main purpose of the interview is to check the suitability of the candidate for the job. And for this purpose, the questions asked are to test the suitability of the candidate for the job, whether he has that balance of judgment, what social traits he has, whether he's alert or not, whether he has critical judgment or not, whether he can deal with stressful situations or not, or whether he has the capability to take right decisions or not, whether he can buck under the stress or not and can deal with stressful situations in a peaceful manner or not. Now friends, we have till this point discussed the recruitment process of higher civil servants in India. But I would like to say that this recruitment process is not free from its bottlenecks. The first major drawback in the recruitment process is the increase in the number of applications. With the increase in the government functions, the departments of the government has increased and thus it requires more workforce. And because of that, the number of applicants have increased and it has become increasingly difficult for Union Public Service Commission to deal with those applicants and carrying out the recruitment process. The second drawback in the recruitment process is that the recruitment process needs streamlining. It means that there is a long time that elapses between the day when the recruitment advertisement is given and the day the candidate is appointed. As a result, there is a loss both for the candidates and as well as for the government. The candidates cannot take up alternative jobs because they fear that they will not be relieved on time if they are selected for the civil services positions. And in the meantime, government is also devoid of the services of competent people. Thus, the recruitment process needs streamlining and the time lapse between the date of the advertisement and the date of the appointment should be decreased. The third drawback in the recruitment process is that there is absence of uniform recruitment rules. Every organization is carrying out the recruitment process in its own ways as per its own rules, leading to corruption and nepotism in the recruitment process. Thus, it is imperative that there should be uniform recruitment rules so that the recruitment process should be free from bias, transparent, and uniformly carried out. Next drawback is the proper placement. Many a times it has been found that those selected, they are not placed at the right position so that they can give their best to the organization. Thus, every effort should be made to properly place the candidates at the right position so that they can give their maximum to the organization and organization can also benefit from the services. Next drawback is lack of public confidence in the recruitment agencies. People have no confidence that the recruitment process carried out by the recruiting agencies is free and transparent, and often they have complained of corruption and nepotism in the recruitment process. So government must take every step to ensure transparency and unbiasedness in the recruitment process by recruiting people of highest ethical standards and integrity into the recruiting agencies like Union Public Service Commission and State Public Service Commissions. The next drawback in the recruitment process is the insufficient time given to the interviews. It is said that the time during which the candidate is interviewed, it is very less and it does not show the real personality of the candidates. So the interviews should be supplemented by the psychological test so that the mindset of the candidates can be judged in the right manner and only then they can be selected in the right manner. Moreover, last but not the least, recruitment process lacks values. There is total erosion of the values while carrying out the recruitment process. There have been numerous reports of the leakages of the question papers and politicians and bureaucrats buying positions. That is, they ask the candidates to bribe them to get plum positions. All this has led to the erosion of values in the recruitment process. So there's a dire need to overcome these drawbacks in the recruitment process and to implement the reforms which have been suggested from time to time by various commissions and committees. Now friends, we are going to discuss the suggestions for improving this recruitment process. And the first suggestion that has come about is to have statistical forecasting of the number and nature of the posts which are to be filled up in future so that we can formulate a national recruitment policy. Now, why this national recruitment policy is required? So that we can have uniform recruitment policy for various positions and thus leaving that room which was there or which was earlier open for corruption and nepotism, closing that door for future bends in the recruitment process. The second suggestion given in the process of improving the recruitment system is that we need to have standards. It means that we should be very clear regarding which post is to be filled up by what time, with what qualifications and with what kind of candidates. So we should have that entire data ready with us beforehand many years in advance so that set standards can be established for carrying out the recruitment process whenever the need to carry out that process is required. Last but not the least, the most important suggestion comes is that there should be clear-cut choice of policy. It means that which positions are to be filled up through promotion, which positions are to be filled up through direct recruitment, that should be clearly laid down beforehand so that whenever the vacancy arises, we are not just caught discussing that whether we need to fill up this position through promotion or through direct recruitment. So we should be very clear that middle and junior level positions should be taken up through direct recruitment and the lowest level positions be taken up through promotion and highest level positions again they are to be taken up through direct recruitment. So Glenn Stahl has very clearly said that recruitment is the cornerstone of the entire personnel structure. And if recruitment is carried out properly, right persons will be selected. And so we must take steps to strengthen the recruitment process by implementing the suggestions given. Second, Administrative Reforms Commission has also given various suggestions towards improving the recruitment system of civil servants in India. In its 10th report on refurbishing personnel administration in India, it has given wide-ranging suggestions to improve the recruitment of higher civil servants in India. Though these recommendations have not been implemented as yet, but still they are worth mentioning. The very first suggestion which the second ARC has given is about the stage of entry into the civil services. Presently, those who enter the civil service are graduates from any stream, maybe humanities, social sciences, commerce, or they may be engineers or they may be MBBS doctors. But second ARC had given a wide ranging, a very strong recommendation that we must tap candidates after their 12th. So it has suggested preschool as well as post-school grooming system of tapping the candidates after their 12th class into the civil services. Further, it has also suggested reduction in the age of entry into the examination and number of attempts. The main purpose is to catch the civil servants at a younger age rather than taking them to the middle age. Now we are going to discuss in detail about the Central Civil Services. Firstly, let us take up Central Civil Services Group A. Now, the recruitment to the Central Civil Service Group A, B non-technical services is done by Union Public Service Commission through the Common Entrance Exam, which is conducted along with the recruitment of the All India Services. Separate examination is conducted by UPSC for the technical services of health, engineering, biotechnology, etc. The most important Central Service Group B is the Central Secretariat Service, and these are also gazetted positions. Third category is Central Services Group C. It's a non-gazetted service, and the recruitment to this is done by Staff Selection Commission. For example, Central Secretariat Clerical Service. Now friends, we are going to discuss the third category of services, State Civil Services. Now the officers of the State Civil Service, it administers subjects which are under the exclusive domain of the state government and are included in the state list of the 7th schedule of the Indian Constitution, like agriculture, health, etc. The duties of the officers of the State Civil Services are confined to the territorial boundaries of the state unless they are working on deputation for the central government. According to Article 309 of the Indian Constitution, the recruitment and service conditions of the officers of the State Civil Services, they are guided by the acts of the respective state legislatures. According to Article 310 of the Indian Constitution, the members of the State Civil Service hold office during the pleasure of the Governor of the state. The provisions for safeguarding the interests of the State Civil Service officers are given in Article 311 of the Indian Constitution. Friends, now let us take up the classification of State Civil Services. State Civil Services are classified as Group A, B and C services. Apart from this, they are also classified as gazetted and non-gazetted services. Gazetted services are those who are included in the Government Gazette, and non-gazetted services are those which are not included in the Government Gazette. Apart from that, the civil services in the states are also classified as subordinate services and ministerial services. Now, we have till this point discussed the classification of services in India as All India Services, Central Services and State Civil Services. We have discussed that UPSC conducts recruitment for the All India Services and Central Civil Services, and State Public Service Commission conducts recruitment for the State Civil Services. But there is a procedure for the induction of the officers of the State Civil Services into All India Services, and that is based on the formula 1:3. That is 33% of the positions in the IAS, IPS and IFS are filled from the State Civil Services through the process of promotion. Now we are going to discuss the recruitment into the State Civil Services. Every state has a State Public Service Commission, and every State Public Service Commission conducts examination for recruitment into the State Civil Services. Recruitment is done both through direct recruitment process as well as through indirect recruitment process. Now the categories of State Civil Services for which direct recruitment is undertaken is State Administrative Service, BDPO, Tehsildar, Talukdar, State Police Service, etc. and any other class 1 or class 2 service which is notified by the state government can also be recruited through direct recruitment process. Now there are various key issues which require reform with regard to the functioning of the civil services in India. For example, reforms are required with regard to the structure of the civil services, their classification pattern, their recruitment pattern, their promotion pattern, capacity building pattern, with regard to inculcating professional skills amongst the civil servants, developing modernity and ensuring political, judicial, financial, economic accountability, and above all, the civil servants must be aware of the fact that they are accountable to people at large. So these are the reform issues which must be included in the functioning of the civil services, because we have found that over these decades after independence, civil services have been mired into various controversies and they have forgotten about various accountability mechanisms. So we must ensure that these reforms are introduced at the earliest in the functioning of civil services. Various attempts have been made with regard to reforming the civil services in India. In line of these attempts, the Government of India has set up various commissions and committees, and the most important committee set up was the Santhanam Committee in 1964. Now, this committee has given suggestions with regard to the conduct of civil servants while filing their income tax assets and taking gifts, and it has also suggested changes in Article 311 of the Constitution while taking disciplinary action against the civil servants. The second most important committee set up was the Hota Committee in the year 2004. This committee had recommended amendments in the Prevention of Corruption Act to safeguard the honest civil servants, enactment of the Code of Conduct for the civil servants, Code of Ethics for the civil servants, and Code of Governance for the civil servants. The latest in line of the reforms is the second ARC report, which was given by the Administrative Reforms Commission. Now, this commission had given very wide-ranging, strong recommendations of intensive performance review of the officers. It had suggested intensive performance review of the officers at two stages, one after 14 years of service and second after 20 years of service. It had suggested that those officers who are unfit to continue in their jobs, their jobs should be discarded. And the initial appointment should only be made for 20 years. After 20 years, when their performance is reviewed, if they are fit to continue, only then their jobs will continue. Otherwise, they will be given compulsory retirement. So friends, to conclude, I would say that we have discussed the classification of civil services in India, which is a three-tier classification into All India Services, Central Services, and State Civil Services. We have discussed that All India Service Officers, they are Group A Service Officers. Central and State Service Officers are Group A, B and C Service Officers. We have seen that how All India Service Officers have been serving both the Union Government and the State Government. Central Civil Service Officers, they serve the Union Government, and the State Civil Service Officers serve the State Government exclusively. All these services are the strong pillars of the administrative system of the country, with All India Service Officers serving both the Union and the State Government. It is said that though All India Service Officers are All India in character, but if we see the actual functioning of the services, Central Civil Service Officers, they have a wider All India character than All India Service Officers, because they serve the entire country under the Union Government. They go and serve all the departments of the Union Government which are located in the states. Thank you.